Hi everyone, my name is Kelly and I'm an alcoholic. Help me get the meeting started with the serenity prayer, please.
God,
grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and wisdom to know the difference. Amen. And God, please enable me to set aside everything I think I know for an open mind and a new experience. Help me see the truth about this book, the meetings, the 12 steps of my disease, my physical craving after I start to drink, and my mental obsession before I start to drink, and the unmanageability of my life. Help me see the truth about my need to come to believe in a power greater than myself, and the failure of my life run on self-will, and my decision to turn my will and my life over to God. Woo. Okay, got a little nervous when I seen how many people were here. I'm like, okay, I'm out of here. Let me get my cookies and my coffee and run. What's the name of our meeting Saturday?
Euclid Saturday.
Last time I led at the club, it was called Willoughby Saturday. So I like to say, oh, I remember when the old club, since we moved, you know, but the electricity was off for some reason, and we had to move the table up to by the front windows, and I didn't have a podium to hide behind. I'm like, well, I can't just stand here. I should just sit down. But I didn't. It's great to be asked to lead and to chair and whatever it is they asked me to do when it comes to the meetings. And I remember the first time I ran into Carol Dold at the Just for Today Club when it was up the street. It's like I knew I would start running into people I drank with in the old days. Mm-hmm. And it's inevitable. So it's funny, you know, to see people. It's a much better way of life, that's for sure. But a little bit about myself. I've got three brothers. So my family, you know, there's four boys and my dad. You know, so five kids, and you know, we tortured mom from the get-go. I remember, trying to do things my way. You know, there's specific chores to be done. I'd be the one to be like, oh, my stomach hurts. I gotta go to the bathroom, or you know, we spend all day outside playing like kids do. You know, I had my paper route, the press, so that was the afternoon paper route. And, you know, there's just chores you have to do, and I would just try and get out of them, you know. Blame my little brothers, you know, back then they're like 5 years old. Get Arthur to do it. took that bad attitude into high school. Always not happy with where I was at. Kept a lot of fantasy books in my back pocket. I should have probably kept my English book in my back pocket instead. Did the bare minimum to get through high school, the lowest D average. I read a lot though. I read those science fiction books. I always wanted to be somewhere else, you know, probably off this world, you know. That's how I looked at it. At a very young age, I was introduced to AA high school. They actually set up a insight program for me and my friend. We kept getting in trouble. I don't know if it rolled over to your grade, Carol. Yeah. But they set it up for us. Instead of just kicking us out of school, they gave us an opportunity to talk to a counselor. And I pretty much used that pass to say, I got to go talk to Mr. C and go outside, smoke, go see him, get the pass, and go back to class. And he did have one of the ninth graders take me to an AA meeting. And back then, all I remember was I could smoke at this church. I'm super young. That's all I really remember. You know, I remember this guy sitting across from me talking about chewing his teeth. I didn't know what he was talking about. I sure didn't remember any of this stuff. But, you know, I was young, 17, 18. And for sure that something, the seed was planted because, you know, I took myself to the Army, joined the Army. For 2 years, I lucked out. 2 years regular Army, I got to go to Germany, the best beer, beautiful women, and I was a cook, so I had a set schedule, 2 days on, basically, and then that every other day, you could stay out till all the bars closed. It was a great schedule. You know, the recruiters told me not to be a cook. You're going to work. You're not going to do this and that. And I'm like, nope, so I want to do. And I was really happy I did it. You know, I was really happy I had that schedule. All the other guys had to do their PT in the morning. And no matter what they were drinking, they had to show up. You know, we didn't have to do the specific cleaning chores. If it was my morning off, I'd stay in bed, go to the mess hall, get food, and certain field problems, they'd send us to the field, and whatever station was having us there, I'd get assigned to their cooks. I didn't even have to talk to my CO or first sergeant or anything. The one time the cook was I don't know if I should say he was an alcoholic, but boy, was he a drinker. He picked us up at the train station. We went right to the bar. He was still in his cook whites. I knew I was in the right place. As long as I show up to work, don't bring any trouble to this guy, I could do what I want. There was only 12 permanent party members at that place. And when me and the two other guys would go into town, the women wouldn't let us order beer in American. We had to speak German. It was pretty cool. But it's like we had the run of the town. Anywhere we go, there was no Americans. And just as long as I didn't bring trouble to the cook, you know, to the head cook. And one field problem, I drank so much, the lieutenant told me I should switch to whatever doesn't smell on your breath so bad. I just blew it off. And, you know, we were in Tent City, but they had TVs and stuff set up for us. I just, like, whatever. Did my driver's training over there drunk. One time, the cousin was stationed there. I couldn't understand why all the people were saying my name. I'm serving them food, and they're pronouncing my name wrong. Hey, your cousin lives upstairs. So I took his coat with his army patch, his unit patch, so I could go to the NCO club at his base. Because when the MPs show up, they could just look through the room. You have the wrong patch on, you're going. You're going to be in trouble. So I had the right patch on. I could sit and drink, even though I'm supposed to be in, you know, the big tents. The tents will hold like 100 people, you know. But I'm supposed to be at Tent City, not on base. But however I could shoot a move, I would do it, you know. I was in the reserves for quite a long time, and I don't remember never driving those fuel trucks sober. And that finally caught up to me, you know. But didn't affect me, you know. It didn't affect me at all. I kept on drinking through my first marriage. When it was time to get divorced, I was telling, we had a roommate, and I was blaming all the problems on him. You know, you told on me, it's your fault. You gotta go. The wife's leaving, the kids, she's taking the kids. You gotta go. It's just gonna be me and the cat. And the cat, she was smart, she ran away too. I miss my cat, you know, I miss her. And by that time, my dad had already been in the program of Alcoholics Anonymous, and other people were saying stuff, you know, you got a problem, you know, you drank too much, blah, 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 you know, in one ear, out the other. But all those years, you know, since high school, you know, last 20-some years, I had that, you know, that impending doom, that morbid thoughts, you know, like Bill talks about, because I knew I was doing something wrong, and I didn't know what to do about it. I knew I had a problem, I don't know what to do about it. And, you know, like step one says, you know, I was powerless. I didn't know that back then. I couldn't come up with a good enough excuse. I couldn't, you know, shoot a move or whatever to keep going. I finally got the nudge from the judge. And the first time offenders program said something like, you got to do one 12-step meeting for every week of class you have with us. And we were in a special class. It was just eight weeks. So I'm like, eight meetings? I can do that in a week. But went downtown to go get a meeting schedule. And I show up at a building my mom had sent me to a year earlier or whatever to get some literature for her. And I call her, I'm like, Ma, what floor do I need to go to? She's like, knucklehead, you're at the Al-Anon building. You need to go down to 13th Street, go to AA meeting. Or get the, you know, go to the AA, the central office. So I walked down there and got my book, and I already knew where the club was. This club here was the old club. I love saying that. At Shore Center. It was about a 6-minute walk from my house. I had already been walking by it, seeing people outside smoking. There was, I knew where to go by then. I got that guidebook, went to the condo, and I just waited and waited. It was a Wednesday, and I probably read the Serenity Prayer on the back of that 10 times in that little 6-minute walk. Just, you know, but when I went in the door, it felt like the monkey was off my back. So I knew what to expect there. I had been going to Detroit a lot the last 10 years and going to the clubs up there, the dances on Friday and Saturday. The clubs probably, the meeting place up there is real small, but the rooms where they play cards and the pool table is huge. And I would sit out there while my friend was inside doing meetings, and people were real nice, and they welcomed me. They didn't say anything how rude I was or inconsiderate, because I was buzzed all the time, and you know, just I look at it now as being disrespectful. I didn't know. I didn't have a clue, though. But, you know, they kept saying, come back, you know, and like I said, my dad was already in the program, and he was saying stuff like, you know, come to Don's Men's tonight. They got free hot dogs. I'm like, no, I'm too buzzed. Come on, we need a good laugh. Show, come on with us, you know. I wouldn't go, but, you know, I knew, you know, since I had been to the club up in Michigan, I knew what to expect. And I went to a couple classes up there years ago, and all I got out of it was, you know, hey, the doctor says you guys got to go. I was with a bunch of women that were crying. I'm like, doctor says you got to go. It's not me. It's you guys. You know, when it was time, it was time. And, you know, that first meeting I showed up to at Night and Day was Let's Learn Together. And I've got the book marked in yellow on that page. It's just funny when you decide, you know, when you come in and start studying the big book, what page is presented to you the first time. For me, it was the page with the word insane on it, the insanity of thinking, you know, what insane thought I have before I drink. And I relate to that instantly. You know, so within a week, I had a book. And, you know, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, went to meetings. Maybe Sunday, I went to the meeting at the club, and there was too many people there. So that's the one meeting I didn't stand up and introduce myself. I was too shy. I got there a little late and sat way in the back. And I just didn't want anyone looking at me. But Sunday night, I went back. It was back to basics is what we called it back then. Well, my spy day is 4 February of 08, praise God. So, you know, whatever, 6th or 7th of February, something like that, 7th, 8th of February. We back to basics. They were on the second meeting, so steps 2, 3, and 4. But the secretary says, you know, it's okay, we're not on step 1. I'm like, what, you know. But, you know, sit here and absorb what you get, and you'll learn something, and, you know, we'll start over. So within a couple months, they had taken me through the steps. You know, by that time, I already got a sponsor outside of that meeting, and he got me into the big book right away also. And really, you know, we still, you know, it's what, almost 5 years later, 4.5 years later, and nothing's changed, you know, the first week, every day, really, you know. Step 1, I have no power. We keep studying the big book, and, you know, it's like 50-some pages. 50-some pages of directions are just on step 1. That tells me it's, you know, super important, that step I have to do by myself 100% every day. No one can help me, because I can relate to the old days where people are calling me names, you know, and, you know, junkie, drunk, whatever. You can call me anything, just don't call me late for dinner. And, you know, until I was ready to accept it, you know, there's no help to be found. But, you know, 50-some pages on step 1, you know, and it comes down to I have no power. And it doesn't feel good when I do that, you know, when I think of it like that. No matter what, I'm going to drink, because I have no power. And So I think that's that right there, that first step experience has, you know, propelled me to stay on the beam, stay on the track, and do the rest of the steps. You know, because if I'm powerless and I'm an alcoholic and my spiritual malady, you know, it should want me to just get this crap out, you know, as fast as possible. You know, if I have no power, and there is power I could tap into, and how do I do that? You know, the rest of the steps. So that's how I look at it. You know, work, get in the book as fast as possible. You know, if I'm an alcoholic, you know, phenomenon of craving, two words. I should want to get rid of that spiritual malady, and you know, that's. I had started a meeting up in Michigan. I moved up there last year, and that was the reading I picked. Since there was no home group members, I could do it. Page 62, Selfishness and Self-Centeredness. That's what we read every week. I'm like, you guys, if we want to change it, sign the home group roster, and then we'll start reading the, you know, regular readings or whatever. We can pick anything we want to read. But that's what I picked every week to, you know, it's not as important as what I did, it's why I did it. You want to know why, I read that page, but don't think about it. I got my little notes today. I lost my little photo. You see these 4x6s, my sponsored. I put them out all over the place. I've got one that's real old, and it's breaks the steps down into four little things: surrender, acceptance, restitution, and guidance. And I usually look at that in case I go get a brain cramp. I could just look down and say, oh, okay, let me talk about this now. But, you know, it's, you know, if I had that first step experience and you know, I want to get the power, and the power is God, you know, to me it was like, back then, you know, I didn't have God in my life ever. And through everyone's experience, strength and hope talk to me, I'm like, yeah, I never thought, you know, I never had God. You know, to me, God is like going to church, and church days for me is football day, food day, Kelly day. And then I'm thinking about it, wait, every day of the week is Kelly day. You know, football Thursday, Sundays, Mondays, and then I could stretch out the rest of the week. You know, just insane excuses, you know, the insane thinking, whatever it is I can come up with to, you know, do things my way. I really didn't need an excuse to drink. The birds are chirping too loud outside. Let's drink. So, you know, my sponsor did it right out of the big book. He says, you know, you can use my God. I'm like, okay, great. I'm still using it. I haven't given it back. God is love, and love is all. And make a decision. You know, if I've got a new employer, I just think I should turn my will and my life over to them, my thinking and my actions. And when they told it to me like that, it makes a lot of sense. Just like I said, that first page I open up, the insane thinking before we drink. You know, all actions born on thought. If I break it down like that, you know, only one thought at a time I could process. And, you know, I make a decision, but if I don't do anything, nothing's going to happen. I made a decision to turn the light on this morning when I got up, but if I didn't actually take action and go over there and flip it, I'd have been sitting in the dark till whenever time, you know, whenever we texted each other. So it's the same thing with step three. I make a decision, and I got to follow it by action. And it's kind of like a key word, action. Willingness and action. Two words that I just keep hearing over and over and over again. Willingness, willingness. Willingness is to do so cheerfully. We read how it works almost every meeting. Honesty, open-mindedness, willingness. So we used to ask the new guys, you know, go home and define those. You know, and see what you come up with. And I would always cheat and say willingness to do so cheerfully. And, you know, give you guys a head start. It's all about getting rid of what blocks me from God. And it's, you know, the first time is in the fourth step. My first fourth step, I did about as good as what the big book was. Six examples. I'm done. You know, I come up with excuses. The dog ate my paper. I don't even have a dog, you know. What it is, I'm lazy is what it is. You know, I'm full of fear. Well, guess what? There's a page and a prayer to remove the fear. So no matter how I look at it, you know, there's no more moves I could shoot. It's all, you know, it's in the book. Here, follow the directions. My experience is what I've learned from everyone that's come before me, and experience shows that if I follow the recipe in the book, the compulsion to drink will be removed. And, you know, to drink is to die, and knowing that, I'll still drink. So yeah, once again, right back to better do the steps. I better remove what blocks me from God. Here in Cleveland, we have the four absolutes on the wall everywhere I go. And, you know, the first time they ask us, you know, in the fourth step, it's saying the opposite of the four absolutes. We have them on the wall, but it's not in the big book. But the opposite is in the big book. So I could really specifically see where, you know, what's blocking me from God. And my fifth step is, you know, I've been so delusional for so long. Like I said, way back when, you know, Dad's like, you should go to a meeting, or, you know, you drink too much, or, you know, the house stinks. I went to his house, and I was sick. I went there, you know, for chicken noodle soup for Mom, you know, a couple days. And, you know, 3 years later, I left. So, you know, he's like bringing AA friends home to do step work. And, you know, hey, the house is pretty smoky, you know. We'll have to go outside. And I'm saying everything is okay. I'm so delusional. You know, I've been so used to telling myself things are okay that I need to share with another person. You know, admit to God and to myself and to another person. I need someone that's gone through the steps before me to say, hey, this is what's going on, and, you know, this is where you're wrong. And, you know, here's a dictionary. Why don't you look up a few words here? Your definition of these words is, you know, distorted. I think we should do our fifth step with our sponsor. That way he gets to know you better. And that way in the future he could, you know, certain things will come back to him when you start going off the path. Step 6 and 7, more willingness, more action, you know, more prayers. Step 8, make a list to become willing. That's pretty easy. I like that. That's an easy step, you know, for a lazy guy like me. I got a little note here. Step 4 through 9 is 20 pages, you know, in the big book, the directions. Not too much to it. Not too much to start getting worried. No, I don't want to do this. I don't want to do that. We're talking about making amends. I think I started making amends the day I joined AA. I heard my mom talking to my aunt a few years ago. All it did was make my ego go, go to a meeting, talk to the guys, you know, they pop it real fast. But yeah, it's nice to hear Mom talk, you know, to the family members. Tell them, Don, today, you know, that compulsion's been gone. I'm house sitting, I'm babysitting, I'm house sitting, and the kids, you know, they've got their kids over, their friends, and so, you know, I'm at the sink 2-3 times a day, snacks and whatnot, lunch, breakfast, lunch, snacks, all that mess. I think the kids feel the need to dirty every glass in the house, so I'm rinsing them. But there's some kind of blueberry vodka up there, and I'm thinking, wow, they make so many vodkas nowadays, you know. The liquor cabinet's over there, and there's beer in the fridge. I don't even think about that. I'm thinking, what a miracle it is that my brother would even give me the keys to his house, the keys to his car. You know, hey, we're leaving for 2 weeks. Will you watch the house for us? We can't take the dog. You know, I still have the key to my mom's house. Friends in the program, you know, hey, can you watch the house for me? You know, I don't think people would have done that a few years ago. You know, Mom never took the key away, you know. The people that are closest to you, we torture all our lives, you know, they still, you know, hang on to the hope. But really, I mean, friends and family ask you to do stuff like that. It's just a miracle. when I got a new sponsor, he says, what steps are you on? Like, was this a trick question? I just assume you're going to make me start over, you know. But when I assume things, I have expectations. That's just like taking a resentment and gift wrapping it. Those expectations, I just dig myself a hole. So I'm like, continue, improve, practice. 10, 11, 12. You know, when we get to those steps, that's what it is. You know, the walking around steps, the guidance steps. At the end of my readings in the morning, page 88 somewhere, it says something like, us alcoholics are undisciplined, so we let God discipline us in the way outlined. And I think that's, you know, right there for step 11, you know, upon awakening, when we retire at night. And, you know, at the end, you know, because that's something I need to do every day, is pray and meditate. But I use that little sentence when I work with new guys. We're undisciplined, and we're going to discipline you the way, you know, God says. But, you know, we're going to do it the book, you know. So you've got 1 week to do your resentments. You've got 1 week to do resentments. Two little sentences in the book. Then we're going to, and then by the next Tuesday, we're going to do our fears. And then by the third Tuesday, we'll do, you know, so we're going to do something different. We're going to be disciplined. But when it comes to prayer and meditation and our beginner's big book, our back to basics, we do it like the old timers, and we write down our thoughts. We have quiet time, and we write down our thoughts. I figure if I put something good in my head first thing in the morning, and then think my thoughts, like I said, only one at a time. I'm going on tangents like this, but only one at a time I can write down. And then I check them on the four absolutes. And if it's self-will, if it doesn't add up to those, then it's self-will. I can cross it off. I don't need to share that with anyone. And if it's something good and positive, I can share it with someone. At the meeting, we go through the room, and anyone that wants to share can share. And then what I do is I write down at least one thing from everyone in the meeting that shares. To me, that's three-way communication with God. He is talking to me through you. So if anyone has anything positive that they got in their morning or their prayers or anything, share it with someone. They might need to hear it. And it works. Step 12, we were talking about the golf outing last year. And I sat at that seventh hole and I studied my 12 and 12. It takes a long time for the golfers to come through. And I wrote a little bit of notes. And the one thing I can remember, you know, is the joy of living is the theme of this step. And action is its key word. So if all else fails, work with another alcoholic. There's a whole chapter on directions on how to do that. It's pretty cool. I went through the steps, and I want to thank Carol again for asking me, because she substitute chaired a couple times this last 4 months, and I was happened to be the lead, so I'm like, yeah, I'll lead for you. Didn't you hear me enough? And I really enjoy when people ask me to lead. I like to talk. It's one way to do 12-step work. It's actually quite easy to come mumble a little bit. No, stay in the book. Bill Wilson wrote, sobriety through the teaching and practice of the 12 steps, the sole purpose of the AA group. That tells me that my comments at a meeting should be out of the book, and that that when I lead, I should talk about the prescription that they outline in the book. There's lots of drama in my life, but if I talk about drama, there's some new people I don't know, they might be new, and they'll be like, well, I don't, you know, I could say, you know, I'm one fight away from being in jail, and one paycheck away from being homeless, and I don't have a car, and these people are like, the newcomers are like, well, I've got a car. Or, you know, my girlfriend loves me, and my cat didn't run away. Maybe I'm not an alcoholic. I didn't even talk about alcoholism. So, you know, I leave the drama out and talk about drama before the meeting. I know not to call a sponsor, just be like, well, how was your prayers today? How was your meditation? So I do that first thing, and the day goes way better. It goes way better when I stay out of the way, though, you know. But being still inexperienced, you know, I come up with all kinds of absurd thoughts and ideas, and I pay the price. I love that sentence in the book. Well, there's all so many good sentences. I want to thank everyone for being here. Tradition 1 says, personal recovery depends upon AA unity. I can't come to the club and talk to the chair. It's just not going to work. We of Alcoholics Anonymous, it's a week program. We have to come together, and that's the timer. It means I have to stop. I just called her phone from my pocket. I have to come to the meetings. I have to see God working in other people's lives. You know, it just is another time, willingness. You know, if I see God working in your guys' life, or do I know this guy from day one. I know that guy back there from day one. This guy over here, about the first couple months I went to your Monday meeting before they stole me away to Humble. Do I believe they believe in God? Yeah, I believe so. And that's belief enough. And that's all it takes to get started. You know, like, I'm powerless. I need power. And, let God direct me. The ABCs, first three steps. That's why I like my little set-aside prayer. I want to thank you all again, and let's do the Lord's Prayer.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Coming back. Just